Good evening, everybody. I'd like to call to order this evening's meeting of the St. Louis Park Telecommunications Advisory Commission for, what is it, the 12th of August. Roll call for starters.
Maren Anderson?
Yes, here.
Dale Hartman?
Here.
Cindy Hoffman?
Here.
Toby Keeler?
Present.
Bruce Browning?
Present.
Ralph Peterson and Andrew Reinhardt are not present.
Okay. Next item on tonight's agenda, approval of the minutes from our last meeting. I would entertain a motion if there is one. Has everyone had a chance to look? Do I hear a second?
I will second that motion.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Motion carries. Next item on our agenda, adoption of tonight's agenda. Any changes or modifications that anybody wants to propose? Are we good? Toby?
Move to adopt.
Okay. Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Next item is public comment, and we have nobody here this evening for a comment, so I guess we can move on to item number 6 under reports and discussion. And the first item on tonight's agenda is the CenturyLink franchise process. And Maren, I'm going to throw it over to you. You've got to review a little bit about what we talked about this past week.
Sure. So we have received a marked up copy of the CenturyLink franchise. We have formed a negotiating team of Brian Grogan, our outside counsel, three telecommunicom members being Toby, Bruce, and myself, and three city staff being John, Reg, and Jackie. Our city attorney is going to be copied on any emails about legal questions or strategy. We had a full negotiating team last week to discuss our strategy, and then we assigned Brian, Toby, Jackie, and Reg for the first meeting with CenturyLink. And they will report back to the group with what happens at that meeting. That first meeting is scheduled for August 17th, and we can expect meetings about every 2 weeks. The next telecom meeting of all of us is scheduled for October 14th, but we can call a special commission meeting if we want to.
Does anybody have any questions at this point? It's a little early yet, but I think things are moving fairly smoothly as far as I know at this point. And Monday's meeting will shed a little more light on CenturyLink's franchise. If there is nothing else, I think we can go ahead and move on to items B and C. Clint Pyers, our Chief Information Officer for the city, is here tonight, and he's going to do a presentation on fiber optic study and some city council goals for us coming up. So, Clint, it's all yours.
Thank you, Chair Browning and Commissioners. It's wonderful to be here tonight. It's been a while since I've had the pleasure of addressing you. And as the Chairman Browning said, we'd like to address two issues tonight. One being the, if you recall, some of you were on the commission when we completed the 2012 fiber optic study that was completed in late 2012, had a number of recommendations. And what we've been doing since then is providing an annual update to the commission on progress that we're making relative to those recommendations. The second item has to do with something Commission may not be aware of. It's a relatively new item, 6C, and that's the Council Goals and Priorities. And what makes that particularly relevant for the Telecommunications Advisory Commission is that, as you'll see, the City Council has identified a very specific goal and priority related to St. Louis Park becoming an increasingly technologically connected community. And so that's going to have ramifications for the next 10 years if the City Council gets its way, which it will. Okay. To refresh your memory, and for those of you who weren't here at the time, when we conducted the 2012 fiber policy study, it really came out of a couple of policy questions that had been being discussed for about a year prior to the study being done. One policy question was simply, what else, if anything, might be done with the existing city school-owned fiber optic network beyond existing institutional uses? And in a nutshell, that means that the city buildings and the St. Louis Park Independent School District buildings We're fully connected for connecting data and transmitting data, voice, phone, and video, and radio, I should say. And the question was, what else could we do with that existing network since we have additional capacity? And the second policy question council wanted us to wrestle with was, should the city provide any requirements or incentives to include fiber optic facilities in new construction or significantly remodeled buildings or other assets? So what that means is that if we do have a new building going up, could be residential, could be commercial, should the infrastructure inside of that building have requirements, or should there be incentives so that the owner of that building provides broadband capability not only to the building but within the building, to the various workspaces and living spaces? The project goals that came out of those questions focused on three different things then on a more specific level. What are the options for maximizing the benefits of the existing city infrastructure? What are the options for expanding that infrastructure when we have the opportunity? And what are the options for city actions that could facilitate private construction of infrastructure? And part of what lies behind this is the idea that the City Council and the TAC have been interested in providing more broadband options in St. Louis Park for many years. And one of the questions was in the study, how could we do that? What would be some of the options we would have in front of us? So the study presented a range of findings and potential strategies. The major findings, first of all, is again, the city has met most internal communication needs through its fiber optic network. Same would be true for the schools. Secondly, fiber represents the emerging standard for broadband and the most scalable and capable broadband technologies. Though the study happened in 2012, I would argue that that's still the case, that nothing has really surpassed fiber, and it won't until we can find something that goes faster than the speed of light. And only I can go faster than the speed of light today. Third, that the availability of consumer broadband products has increased in St. Louis Park since it was last evaluated. That was in 2006, and that was part of a very comprehensive market survey some of you remember as a prelude to the Wi-Fi pilot program. You needed to find out what St. Louis Park residents and businesses were actually using, what services they had, and what they wanted. And at that time, we were able to evaluate who had access to what kinds of services. And then, that being said, St. Louis Park consumers do not have access to state-of-the-art fiber networks. And so while we see an expansion of fiber through both the private sector and the public sector, actually getting fiber access to a premise, to a home, or to a business is still fairly rare. We're starting to see it in some other cities right next door to us. We have U.S. Internet installing fiber to the premise in Minneapolis. And they actually expressed some interest in doing something similar in St. Louis Park. As far as the recommendations go and some of the updates, looking at the first one, one of them was to lease access to existing fiber and conduit to enable private investment. So, city owns a lot of conduit in the ground, a lot of strands of fiber. We're using some of that for our own purposes. The schools are doing the same. Could we make that available to other providers? And to date, we have been approached by about a half dozen providers and expressing interest in knowing where our fiber is so that when they get a development project, they might be willing to partner with us. We have not had a specific agreement yet. We have also, as part of the study in 2012, we had approached some of the major carriers like Comcast, like CenturyLink, to see if they had any interest in leasing some of the fiber assets as well. There has been no interest expressed to date. Second recommendation was to incrementally expand the city fiber. And there were some very specific areas where the study recommended that occur. One of them is to build fiber between Park Nicollet's facilities. And that would include, obviously, their hospital and the Park Nicollet Clinic. So we're both east and west of Highway 100, but also include the Melrose Institute off of 36th Street and Beltline Boulevard. And the idea here is that the city owns a significant amount of conduit along Excelsior Boulevard from Louisiana Avenue all the way to the east side of the Highway 100 bridge. As it turns out, we are partnering with Hennepin County on a separate project that is going to enable us to actually put fiber in that conduit this year. That's going to allow us then the opportunity to sit down with ParkNIC and see if there are any partnership options that they still want to take advantage of. You have to have the fiber in place in order to do that. But they obviously are an important player in St. Louis Park and an important partner in our emergency medical response as a community. Building fiber to parks and recreation and public works facilities, we, as you will see a little bit later, have added fiber to a number of park shelters. That enables a couple of things. It enables us to provide Wi-Fi coverage to those buildings. We're increasing that. At the same time, because the fiber is there, we're able to put in automated security systems, cameras, locking systems, that kind of thing, that enable us to keep things like restrooms open later in the evening, but also be able to provide the security with camera surveillance. And that has come in quite handy. So we've made some significant progress on that. Building fiber to the city's third water tower, we did not have fiber to the Park Glen Tower, which is the one here right off of Beltline Boulevard. We have since acquired fiber from another provider who had it built there, and they wanted to abandon that, so we purchased that fiber, and we now have access to all three water towers, elevated water towers, that is. That is coming into play in another project, and that is the meter replacement program that's going on in the city of St. Louis Park. About 14,000 meters will be replaced over the next 18 months. And what happens is that those new meters are going to have antennas on the outside of homes that will transmit the readings. Those have to be read over wireless systems. And the way it's structured is that we'll use each of the three water towers to cover all of the city. There'll be antennas up there that will read those meters. And then through the fiber backbone, it'll transmit those readings back to City Hall where they can be processed. Advantage, we don't have to send people around to every home and business now to get a reading. It's much more efficient. And we can do things like leak detection and let people know that there is a leak going on before they get a large bill, you know, several weeks later. And so that hopefully will be another advantage of that. And so these are some of the trickle-down effects, no pun intended, even though it's a water system, of things like fiber, things that can happen eventually if you have enough infrastructure in place. Building fiber to the St. Louis Park Library was another goal. And this is part of a very significant collaboration with Hennepin County. Hennepin County is interested in connecting all of its county buildings. Hennepin County does not own that much fiber in the cities in Hennepin County. So what they're doing is they're partnering with the cities to make use of some of this excess capacity that we have in our system in exchange for building out parts of our system that don't exist yet. So for example, Hennepin County is going to be hooking in the St. Louis Park Library into their system. They're going to be going through St. Louis Park in large part on the city's network, but what they're going to do in exchange is they're going to add fiber where it doesn't exist, for example, along Excelsior Boulevard, down Wooddale Avenue, and we're going to own that fiber, and only part of it will be used by the county for its purposes. So they get their needs met, and we provide extra capacity where we can use it too. So that's a real win-win situation, and it's a way of really addressing this very important goal of keeping libraries modern. Building fiber over time to key economic development targets. I think you've seen some of this at the West End. One of the things that will be happening later this year is development east of the West End on the east side of Utica Avenue. Utica Avenue, that part of Utica Avenue is a private street. It's going to become a public street. When it gets opened up and reconstructed, it's going to get turned over to the city. And while it's open, we're going to be putting conduit and fiber in the ground, have easements to the development to the east there as well to ensure that those developments can have their facilities broadband ready. Continuing to install conduit during capital improvement projects. We have a few major street reconstruction projects going on east and west of the Nature Center in particular. And so we're putting conduit in the ground there. So we're continuing to address that goal. And then complete fiber rings where possible during the course of routine fiber and conduit installation. The goal here is to create redundancy. What we're finding, obviously, is that there's an increasing reliance on fiber. And that because of that, we need redundant connections to our major city buildings. So while the school district and the city have fiber connections to their various buildings, we don't always have a redundant connection. We're now building those in. And we're trying to coordinate all of that so that we can achieve a lot of these goals at the same time. So, for example, in working with Hennepin County to connect the St. Louis Park Library, part of that project is they put in the fibers going to enable us to get a second connection to Fire Station 1. All right, that's vital for us. And so these recommendations out of the 2012 study have made significant progress. Some of the other recommended strategies from that study are as follows. One was to proceed with caution regarding expansive strategies to enable broadband in St. Louis Park. Put in a nutshell, the consultants felt like we would have to really, really think long and hard if the city wanted to build its own fiber to the home and fiber to the business, fiber to the premise kind of network. Those of you who are around might recall that the estimate to do that was about $30 million. And the question really was, would there be a payback for that? And would we be better off waiting to see what emerged in the private sector? And what we are seeing today, and you're already dealing with it, as a matter of fact, as you did in the first item tonight, you're starting to see other companies, CenturyLink in this case, start to make more of their infrastructure available, enhance it, because if they're going to offer video, they're going to have to offer a network that also enables high-speed data transfer. Evaluate a fiber model similar to the alley assessment model. And this will be interesting to see if this ever gets traction. We haven't really delved into it a lot. But the idea behind this was if there's a certain part of town that is interested in high-speed access, maybe there's a way to assess the people along that area of town. Maybe it's a block, maybe it's a set of blocks, and they pay a certain amount in order to get access to fiber to the home. And so it'd be sort of a pay-as-you-go approach. And the reason that's true, similar to an alley assessment model, for those of you who've been around for a long time, most of our alleys are improved. But until they were improved, you had to get at least 50% of the block saying they wanted the alley and that they were willing to pay the assessment in order to do so. Right. So that could be another approach. It's not one that we've had the time to explore yet. And then to expedite local processes and waive fees to facilitate private sector infrastructure. So this would be a situation in which we would look as a city at what are we doing from a process point of view, from a regulatory point of view, that could more easily enable providers to build infrastructure. And one of the incentives might be to waive fees. Well, there's a trade-off there, obviously, because there's a cost to managing things like right-of-way and so forth, too. And some would argue, and Toby, you and I were talking about it earlier, there may be an argument to do just the opposite, because right-of-way is becoming such a valuable commodity. Maybe we look at expanding the fees that we're charging to use it. At any rate, those were the major recommendations. One of the things I did want to do here is to give you a sense of some of the projects going on that you may or may not see. Some of them I've already mentioned. Some of them were carryover projects from 2014, included Highway 7 in Louisiana and the roundabouts. When those were constructed, we needed to relocate the fiber that we had there. We had sanitary sewer work going on along Highway 7 and County Road 25 here, just around City Hall. We have fiber relocation going on next year at Highway 7 and Highway 100. We have a fiber project going on at that Parkland Water Tower for 800 megahertz redundancy. So I mentioned that we had the three water towers wired and we're going to be able to use those for the meter reading project. One of the other purposes for which fiber makes sense is to connect our dispatch system to the 800 megahertz radio system that's used by public safety. Currently, we have a fiber connection that goes up to Napier Street in Golden Valley to the Hennepin County Sheriff's Tower. That's a single link. And if that goes down, then Hennepin County needs to dispatch for us, or we go to an alternate facility. What we'd like to do is build in a redundant system in case that does get cut. We can flip over to another system. Well, another redundant system would be putting a dish on the Parkland Tower, connect it to our partners in Minnetonka, which would get us another route to Hennepin County Sheriff. So again, all enabled by the presence of fiber. 2015 projects, we're looking at significant investment in disaster recovery. This is on a broader level for city purposes, business continuity, backup EOC, redundant fiber ring connections, some of which I mentioned before. But the idea here, again, is that in addition to a fiber getting cut, what if we have a major emergency in the community? How resilient are we so that we can continue our business, so that we can recover from it in a fast way? And part of the answer here is to spread out your facilities in different geographical areas. That's not free, but that's part of what we can do and can be enabled by the existence of a broad fiber network, and we're doing that in conjunction with some other cities. We talked about the Hennepin County project, so this is going to enable fiber expansion on Louisiana Avenue, Meadowbrook Road, Excelsior Boulevard, Wooddale Avenue. And one of the other things that will be happening here in the long term is a Southwest LRT project. And again, in collaboration with the county, what we're going to be able to do is to share some of the fiber strands that will exist under the railroad bed. Okay, and they'll have what are called pullouts, or basically access points on either side of the railroad bed. So they're going to put a lot of fiber in there. County's going to use some of it. State's going to use some of it. And in collaboration with the county, we're going to have access to some of it too. Fiber conduit will be going along Lake Street, west of Louisiana Avenue, as part of the continued Metropolitan Council Environmental Services sewer project. Park Commons West will have the east of Utica Avenue will be having conduit and easements. The Connect the Park project, which is the expansion of the sidewalk system in St. Louis Park, taking advantage in a few areas to add fiber and conduit there. The engineering projects, again, primarily east and west of the Nature Center. And park facilities, and this has become very popular. So this year, we're adding Louisiana Oaks, Birchwood, and the Wolf Park Pavilions, and then the Brick House, which is up by the Nature Center. And in 2016, we've already got on the calendar to add the Oak Hill Shelter and the Aquila. That will complete most of the major park buildings that we have. And again, enable them to have not just Wi-Fi, but better security systems. And I mentioned the automated meter reading project. So talk big picture about some of the strategies and goals that we had from the study, how we've been addressing those, and then I want to give you a pretty good snapshot of activity that's going on this year. What this does not include, to be fair, is all the construction projects going on, street construction. Where there's fiber, there's street construction, it seems, these days. And so you have to be very, very careful and very cautious that fiber doesn't get cut. And we're working very hard at that. But I have to say, with the amount of construction that we've had this year, we've had a significant number of cuts in our fiber, and we've had to have a lot of emergency repairs. But that's the price you pay for an expanded infrastructure as well. And it's one of the reasons you need continued resiliency.
A quick question, Clint. Mm-hmm. If somebody cuts a fiber, who pays for that repair?
If the contractor has, the contractor is typically responsible, but the contractor is responsible for following the rules set by the state and the Gopher State One call. So there's a certain protocol where if you call before you dig, and you have to have utilities located, and if they've been properly located and you still cut it, the contractor is responsible. If they haven't been located and the contractor did not call, the contractor is really responsible.
Do they have a go-to company that's well-schooled in fiber repair?
Yes, we do. We have one on call, and they're able to respond very quickly.
Okay.
We had a recent situation where 144 strand fiber was cut, and it affected our dispatch service. And that happened at 11 o'clock on a Thursday morning. By 11 o'clock that evening, 1,000 additional feet of fiber had been installed and spliced.
Wow.
And that's 288 splices. And I don't know if you've ever spliced fiber, but it's like brain surgery, and takes a lot of work. So it's a good point, Chairperson Browning, that you really need to have all the backup pieces when you build an infrastructure like this. It's easy to build this stuff. The work is in maintaining it. It's kind of like the tail on the dog. And the maintenance comes after the building. So it is a lot to manage.
The kind of a continuation of the same question, really. I'm assuming places are marked when fiber is put into the ground.
Mm-hmm.
So how is it that somebody can manage to disrupt that? I suppose it's the same thing as disrupting a gas line, which I've seen before, too.
Mm-hmm.
Are they not paying attention at the time, or is the cable not marked as well as it should be?
Locates are fairly standard and pretty easy to do. Frankly, it's really up to how cautious the contractor is.
Okay.
And to be fair, most of the contracting work goes on without problems. But there are situations, unfortunately, where the contractor is not as careful, and then we pay the price.
And again, are the places where it's been cut, has it been in conduit or a sewer line type situation or combinations? Or
any variety of situations where the ground gets dug up.
Okay.
So any of what you mentioned and more.
Okay.
Situations. Could be gas, could be somebody putting in a driveway, changing the grade, that kind of thing.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks. We've had them all this year. Okay, so that is really what I want to conclude with on item 6B before moving on to 6C. So are there any other questions from the commission on this item?
One last thing that just came to mind with the Minnetonka Boulevard Bridge. Was there any fiber being moved around during that bridge construction or being added to that?
Yes. As a matter of fact, that was an interesting project that's not even on this list, but it was more of a 2014 project. We found out that when that bridge was being reconstructed, there was a private company that was going to be moving its fiber. And we happened to know because they were taking out permits. And so we approached them and asked them if we could collaborate with them because we didn't have a crossing under Minnetonka Boulevard or across the highway at Minnetonka Boulevard before that. And they said yes, and we got a very good price on getting a crossing. And basically, they trenched and did most of the work under the highway. We were able to go right with them with a couple of extra conduits. And again, it was win-win. So those are some of the things that you try to take advantage of if you can learn about all the projects going on. The challenge is learning about all those projects that are going on to see if you can take advantage of them.
I just wanted to add a comment. I think kudos to the city for the work that has been done since the study took place.
Thank you. There's more to do, and you'll see that in the next item, too. Okay. If there's nothing else, I will move on to the next item then. Item 6C, City Council Goals and Priorities. Each year, the City Council gets together for an annual workshop, and they talk about what they call big, bold ideas. Think about it as visions for the city. Where is the city going in the future based on what City Council members are hearing, ideas they have, and so forth. Council met in January of this year, and again, the primary intent at this workshop was to reach consensus on big, bold goals and priorities for the next 10 years. So what should St. Louis Park look like in 2025, essentially, is what that comes down to. And the council came to a general agreement on five goals and priorities. On February 9th, the staff went back to the council with a summary of what we thought we heard at that workshop to try to get their confirmation. And the council did indicate that what was recorded was consistent with the council's intent from the workshop. Staff also indicated it would take about 90 days from that point to develop some specific strategies and a two-year action plan to address those goals and priorities. And in May and June of this year, staff returned to City Council, and the council made a few modifications, but generally confirmed those five goals and priorities, as well as the strategies that were suggested and the work plan. Now, one could ask, what about years 3 through 10? And what the City Council and City Manager decided to do was to chunk it off and say, what can we do in the first couple of years? Because what actually gets accomplished at the beginning of projects like this might well determine what comes next. And instead of trying to solve all 10 years, because we know things can change. The five priorities and goals are intended to articulate, provide direction to staff as well on those things the council feels will have the most powerful and positive impact in St. Louis Park by 2025. It secondly allows the staff to orient our work plans and resources accordingly. These five priorities and goals will be reviewed annually to make sure they're still relevant, and of course corrections will be made by the council. And the staff, in the process of addressing these goals and priorities, must continue to provide collaborative, high quality, and responsive services to ensure that St. Louis Park is the most desirable place to live, work, and do business. And the point here was, council said, yes, we want to move forward in these specific five areas. That doesn't mean, staff, you're off the hook for everything else. No, you really need to keep everything else going as well. So we need to find ways to integrate that into our daily work in order to keep the service levels high. The five goals and priorities. I know you've been waiting for this, so the curtain's finally up. What are those five goals and priorities? One of them is redevelopment around the three Southwest Light Rail transit stations. And that redevelopment is to be maximized to the fullest extent possible. If you think about that and you've seen what's happened in other parts of the Twin Cities area where light rail has gone in, or other parts of the country, you will notice that things change around the corridor. New developments go up, could be housing, it could be commercial, but it becomes a hub of activity because people can get there and they can get to other places from there. And so we want to take advantage of that to the extent possible. And that corridor, of course, where the railroad is one of the oldest corridors in St. Louis Park, so it is really ripe for redevelopment. Secondly, that St. Louis Park is a leader in environmental stewardship, sustainability, and resiliency. Some of you may be familiar with some of the events that have been going on. I think we had one last night, Jackie, on resiliency. We had about 70 people attend that. And there's more consciousness of the idea of communities taking the lead on these items of being sustainable, of having resiliency. When things happen, it's going to be responded to at the local level first. It's not going to be responded to necessarily by the feds or even the state. Third, that St. Louis Park has top-ranked schools as well as maintaining a diverse housing stock with strong, vibrant neighborhoods. We have those. We want to continue those. St. Louis Park has high-quality community amenities and facilities, and that could be in the form of things like recreational facilities. One of the things council is looking at right now is an outdoor skating rink over by the rec center, to the west of the rec center, and keeping the existing buildings in good shape. And fifth is St. Louis Park is a technology-connected community. Why is that important? We really need to articulate that. We don't do that just for the fun of it. Why is that important? And the conclusion we came to and the council agrees with is that broadband speed and capacity requirements continue to grow. They're not stagnant as technology and the internet continue to evolve. And a community that's connected by a very robust and comprehensive broadband system will set itself apart and be better able to promote economic growth, innovation, community development. If you believe that things like growth and innovation, community development are dependent upon technology, the community, however it's provided and by whoever it's provided, needs to have a strong broadband capacity. High-speed broadband enables the exchange of information in many different forms. It's vital to high-tech and medical industry growth and to the delivery of services in education, health, government, public safety, and the overall quality of life. And given the significant amount of fiber infrastructure that's in place and owned by the city, we're uniquely situated to take advantage of the digital economy. This is not new to you because this is part of the basis of the study that was done in a lot of the conversations that have been had by the commission in the past. And some of the things that we're starting to see evolve now, for example, fiber along Excelsior Boulevard that might connect medical facilities and emergency facilities is a good example of how we can support, for example, the medical industry at a fair price as well. Some of the strategies that have been developed in order to address that particular goal and priority is to first research the strategic options. All right, so this is something that is at a conscious level very new for the city. What have other cities that have already been there done? And what can we copy that would make sense for St. Louis Park? And what can we innovate in terms of strategic options that may have not even been done by other communities? Another strategy is to make sure that we continue to support school and community education initiatives. And so a community is often as strong as its schools and vice versa. We know that. And we have a strong relationship with schools, both public and private. How do we maintain and how do we enhance that with technology? How do we encourage more private market consumer choices? And that's timely for tonight, because what you're doing as a commission and what you will pass on to the city council will hopefully be enabling that additional private market choice, right? That's something that everybody likes. They like to have a choice of more than one. And to also integrate new private carrier technology infrastructure, mini cell towers into a community. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with this, but wireless companies are trying to address the presence of high demand and poor coverage, poor wireless coverage in communities. We all know about Wi-Fi and the challenges of any wireless technology to provide sufficient coverage. Well, the big companies, the AT&Ts and Verizons and Sprints and others, T-Mobile and so forth, have identified in every community where coverage is light, where the signal isn't strong, or where there's high demand and they need to provide additional resources. One of the approaches that they have for that is to put what are called these mini cell towers. They look like little beer barrels, basically, and they can be hung on existing infrastructure, things like flagpoles or street lights, those kinds of things, and they fill in those areas. Some approaches take a much more dramatic approach where they not only have antennas on poles, but they have infrastructure on boulevards, big cabinets and vaults and things like that. And this is a concern because of the perceived uglification of neighborhoods. That's a new word, uglification. You can put it in your dictionary. It'll be on Google next year. And so at the same time, though, people want better service. So how do we find the balance in these technologies that provide better service but are also acceptable from an aesthetic point of view? We're really trying to achieve both, and that isn't always easy. But those are some of the strategies that we really need to deal with if we're going to get the best of technology and the best of services available to our businesses and residents. Another strategy is to support or build broadband public-related infrastructure and target private development opportunities. Are you starting to see some overlap with the study that we had and some of the goals of the study? That's intentional, because we believe that those still make sense from 2011 and 2012, and we are rolling those forward into this 10-year plan. Support community technology applications for enhanced livability of all age groups, from youth to seniors. This will be a very interesting one to me. If you stop and think about it, at a community level, we've been very focused on infrastructure, on fiber, on high speed, and those kinds of things. That does not address what people actually do with the technology to improve their quality of life, and that's across all age groups. And the council is saying we need to play a role in that, because if we're trying to improve the quality of life for our residents and businesses, and technology is going to be a part of that, we need to be a player in that, because part of the quality of life is going to depend on services that we're providing as well. And so what is our role in that? It's a very challenging strategy, but I also think those challenging ones are the most important ones very often. Maximize the speed of broadband deployment. This has to do with making things like excess fiber capacity available to those companies that are interested. Enhance private development broadband readiness. Some have said we should look at the idea of requiring or providing incentives for businesses to include broadband in their new buildings or in significant remodeling efforts. Well, we have been doing that with developments that are especially looking for city assistance. Could be financial assistance in the form of TIF. And as part of that, what we're requiring is that they provide the facilities within their own buildings to make high-speed access available to every living unit and every working unit. We've done that now at the West End. We've done it at Central Park West to the east of it. And we've done it at two other developments, private developments, and we're continuing to do that every time we get a proposal for a new development. So we have been focused most of the time on the public right-of-way, on the streets, and making sure fiber's there. But it does no good if those residents or those structures, those developments along those streets are not ready inside to accept it and use it. So we're trying to do both here. So it's interesting and fun. And I will say the conversations so far have been very collegial, and developers see the advantages of this. and it really has been a win-win situation. Now, it could be that that's going to go into a form of an ordinance someday. Loma Linda, California, for example, has done that, and they require it. Right now, we've been negotiating these situations. There'll be challenges, and those challenges typically are around resources, time, money, people, wisdom. The processes, and this is the one that where I think we can have a big effect. What can we do at a city level to make sure that we have enough in place to regulate things at a correct level, but they're not impediments to getting work done? All right, and can we make improvements there? And I think that's something we can affect very significantly. And the hardest thing is imagination, and that is what are the possibilities? What could we possibly do? And where do we go to for sources of imagination? And my sense is that'll be the community, typically is. So the next step in this process, and again, the City Council is going to formally adopt these five goals and priorities here later this year, and the rollout of this then will start to take place in a more significant way. With respect to this particular goal and priority, what we're looking for is a couple levels of participation. One would be at a bigger picture level. Okay, we have this statement now, we want to be a technology connected community. What does that mean? How can we hone that down and define it? And then what are the specific plans that we could put in place? And that might require multiple groups of people. And it's certainly not just one group for each phase. So I can see, for example, the TAC being a major player in phase one. I can see the school district being a major player in phase one. I can see the Chamber of Commerce, all kinds of big picture thinkers like you folks. And once we get some refinement of that strategy statement into something that's a little bit more specific, then we can bring in the people who can talk about what it would take to build these kinds of things. So it isn't going to happen in 1 year or 2 years. This is a 10-year plan. But from my perspective, what this goal and priority really does is reinforce what the commission has done with respect to the study that was completed in 2012 and our continued progress in addressing the recommendations of that study. So that gives you a little bit of a flavor for what the City Council has been working on and the priority that they are putting on technology going forward here in the next 10 years. And I thank you, and I'm open to questions on this particular item.
Where do we start?
I
like the city's overview, and I like the way things are fitting together. I think we play an important part of that.
Mm-hmm.
Defining technology is a moving target, and it keeps getting faster and harder to zero in on. We're woefully behind in many regards compared to Japan and other places in Europe. When we talk about, when CenturyLink is talking about speeds of 25 megabits per second, that's nothing anymore. Gigabit, 2 gigabit service, which is something that Comcast, I know, is going to be dealing with in some fashion, don't know how or when just yet. But that's more along the line of that's where things are moving. Anything below that is kind of, I won't say it's useless, but it's really slow by today's standards. And those standards are moving quickly. The fiber is a really large part of that. We should be working our best to roll that out in whatever fashion we can and to try and make it affordable to our residents, especially lower-income residents. And I think Comcast has done that to some extent. Reg sent us some things on the essentials piece, and I think that's awesome. And I think that's something that we need to do as a community. So I'm excited about this.
And it's going to take more than one player. It's going
Absolutely.
To take a combination of public and private. I may be wrong, but I do believe fiber is the future.
I agree.
Again, until we go faster than the speed of light, we'll have wireless as well to complement it.
Mm-hmm.
And every service delivery system, whether it's Comcast, CenturyLink, or anybody, ultimately, my guess is, will be delivering services over fiber, at least in a large degree.
Agreed.
Just a question of when. Because it's not free.
Really?
Sorry.
But it can be more reasonable, maybe,
yeah,
with time.
Any other questions, Commissioner?
Thank you, Clint.
Thank you. Appreciate your time.
Appreciate the information. If there are no further questions, item D is a state-of-the-art review due on the 10th anniversary of granting a franchise to Comcast. State-of-the-art is, it's a hard thing to define from my perspective. I kind of think I know where it's going, but it's moving faster sometimes than I can think about. State-of-the-art to me at this point is what we were just talking about, fiber. I think that is where state-of-the-art is. We're not there yet. We're getting there. There's more fiber in the infrastructure than there was before. But it isn't all fiber yet. And all fiber would be, from my perspective, certainly the ideal. Reg, are we just opening this for a discussion at this point?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chair. It's something to kick around, just advance notice. It's this is not due until next year, so mm-hmm. This was the first chance to introduce the topic.
Okay. Go ahead.
Just a question. Does the franchise call out specifically how this is done? Is it just a get-together between the city and Comcast on the review? How does it work, mechanics?
The mechanics would be that the city would hold a public hearing to enable the general public and company to comment and present evidence is the scripture or chapter and verse from the franchise. And so the city and company may enter into good faith negotiations to amend the franchise as necessary to provide system improvements. Just a little further background was that the purpose of this was to make sure that the St. Louis Park system didn't fall behind the other communities at the time when this was all written up. There was a point when there were many cable companies in the Twin Cities area, and what might happen is that in St. Louis Park, the system may be upgraded 1 year, and then the next year Hopkins and Minnetonka and other neighboring communities may upgrade theirs, and we didn't want to feel like we'd be left behind. And now what has happened, frankly, in the industry is that there's been more consolidation over the last 15 years. And so it's really not quite as much of an issue as it was when this kind of language was first put into franchises many years ago. However, it's still relevant and it's in our franchise, so that's why we want to address it.
Is this an option or is it a requirement?
This is an option. This is an option, and as I mentioned in a brief report to you, the five-year anniversary of the franchise was 2011, and at that time the commission opted not to recommend to the city council to do any kind of state-of-the-art review at that time.
Personally, just from my perspective, I think it would be a good exercise. The technology is moving very quickly. I think Comcast, CenturyLink, whoever it is, whoever the providers are, they have a pretty good idea, I think, of what state-of-the-art is. I don't look at state-of-the-art from my perspective as telephone lines or coaxial cable, but that is the world that we live in presently. The closest thing we have in my mind to state-of-the-art right now is really fiber to the home. We're not there yet, but we're starting to move that direction. And, yeah, I think it is worth having a discussion.
And I'll throw my 2 cents worth in. I'm not sure that it would be that we would get a lot of information on state-of-the-art from the public input. I think we'd get a lot of complaints about customer service and so on, those kinds of things, which I don't think is the intent of the review. I may be wrong, but that would be my take on opening it up for public comment, that it would be biased towards the problems of customer service and those kinds of things, as opposed to actually, are we receiving state-of-the-art services to the city? My 2 cents worth.
Also, as I'm thinking about it too, maybe it'd be worthwhile to have some people come in that are leaders in some of that technology and explain a little bit of what's going on. Perhaps fiber manufacturers, maybe some of the technical people some of the people that provide our services right now, to get some feel for where they think it's going, what they're planning on doing with their plants and their head ends and that type of thing. I know it's out there a little bit. I know that we've been approached, obviously, and I think those are good things. But it would be nice to get a better handle on where we are now and where we think we're going to be in another 5 years, if it's possible to do that.
I wasn't here at the last meeting, but Comcast made mention that they're adding thousands of customer service agents in mm-hmm. the near future. And I don't know if any of you have used Comcast customer service where they insist on using voice recognition before you speak to a human, but state-of-the-art customer service may be a touch point that we would want to examine.
I think that's very
because
valid.
Between now and 5 years, how is customer service better someplace else that Comcast could transition toward?
I think that's a part of this discussion, too. You can have great infrastructure, but if there's a problem and it doesn't get addressed in a timely fashion, that's not good for residents within the city. And it's not good for the provider, either. I've had a couple of mixed things with Comcast in the past, and Carly and I have talked about that a little bit. Nobody's perfect. They're making an attempt to get better, and that's part of it, most definitely. But yeah, we could use some improvement in that area, no question about it. And maybe that can be a part of this discussion, too.
I'm not familiar with the voice recognition software that's being used for the customer support.
Well, they say, please tell us what you're calling about, and you say, customer service. They say, I'm sorry, did you say? And so it's basically a way to delay before you get to talk to an actual employee, whatever country that employee might be in.
Okay, and that's what I was wondering, because I know, and it was not Comcast, but one of my colleagues was making a phone call, and it was an overseas call center, and the technology was translating. So the individual did not know or knew very little English, and you could hear it like speaking to the other person's ear, and then she'd relay the message back. She'd like translate it from English into her language, and then it would go back into English. So that is a good point that you bring up. That's why I was just curious.
Yeah, they have touch tone service where you can, you know, press a number for a language other than English or something like that, but they could have something that was more direct about, use all nine numbers for getting through to somebody that can address your problem, rather than having an automated service spend the 2 to 5 minutes before you get put in a waiting for a live agent.
Okay. Thank you.
I know it's not just Comcast, it's not just CenturyLink, it's not just providers. Software companies have the same problem. I wanted to reach through the phone and strangle somebody for one of the software companies that I deal with because the product wasn't working correctly with the new Windows 10 upgrade. I understand some of that, definitely, but when you have to go through multiple trees through a phone system and not get anybody or not get the service that you expect when you've purchased the product is aggravating as hell. So, yeah, they could all be better at it. And I'm hearing some things that make me feel a little bit better, but we're not there yet. And it is, as I say, it's not just the cable companies, but it's companies in general. Customer service stinks. And it should be better than it is. There are some exceptions, but not very many right now.
With thousands of new employees to provide customer service, you'd think you would reach an employee faster.
Mm-hmm.
And
I would
that
agree.
Could be state of the art.
There you go. Any other questions or comments at this point? This will be something that we revisit coming up, I'm sure. Okay. On to item E, which is the complaint log. And I had a conversation with Reg earlier because I was concerned about the word ingress, because there were a number of outages in the cable system in various areas of the city. And the response in many cases, which actually fixed the problem, was ingress, which meant basically that there was a break in the cable allowing outside signal information to leak into the system. And for lack of a technological term, futz up the operation. Once they discovered that, that apparently, in most cases, repaired the problem. I will say again, a lot of the problems that I see in our complaint log that Reg and John both are involved with winds up being escalated, but ultimately the escalation team does a great job of solving most of it. I would think that the ideal would be not to have to go to the escalation team, but to get the problem solved before it has to get to that point. And maybe that's going to be something that gets improved with time. It's just a comment that I have as I look through the logs. Anything else anybody might have along that line?
I'm trying to find it as well, but I know there was one where an individual tried to return the box.
Mm-hmm.
After his brother passed away, and he lived in a different state. And that was kind of, they weren't able to accept it in another state. And I would think with being a barcode on the box that would be able to be somehow linked in the software program, but that's my opinion.
Can you, I don't know how Comcast operates in areas outside of Minnesota, but yeah, this is one of those things where they were in Florida, they were trying to get service, they were trying to get it stopped up here. Does one end talk with the other in that regard from state to state?
Sure, I don't know the specifics of that complaint to answer that. Though.
Okay, maybe you can look at it a little bit later, clarify it for us.
The Comcast does have a UPS delivery service, and I don't know why an agent couldn't tell somebody in Florida, make sure that it goes to the Minneapolis address, here's that address, and then the box would have come back into our service area and it would have been handled properly.
Because it looked like that that his name was also on the count, so he called customer service and they said they could bring a copy of the death certificate to any Comcast office and wrap this up. And brought it to the closest one in Florida, and they said they didn't have access to any Minnesota account information and couldn't help. Yeah. Okay. But as a general rule, is your system set up so that you can view from state to state, or does every state run differently?
Maybe you need a little more specific information, too,
yeah,
as to what it was.
It's number 23, just for informational purposes.
Okay. We can look at that here coming up. Anything else regarding complaints? If not, we can go to item 7, communications from the chair or commissioners or city staff. I don't have anything specifically. Does anybody on the commission have anything to follow up on, or city staff?
I can give you an update on the website redesign that we're working on.
Okay.
We have a team in communications led by myself and Jason Huber, our IT manager, who you've met at previous meetings. And we are working toward a goal of rolling out a redesigned city website by March of 2016. So we've been working very diligently. Right now we're in the process of looking at other websites that we like and figuring out some good categories to redesign the navigation for the website. One of the first measures we took was to put out a SurveyMonkey survey to people about what the features of the website, what they like and don't like, and those types of things, and I believe that was shared with all of you. So we are getting results back on that, and we'll have it available to people at least through the end of this month, possibly longer. So that information will be very useful to us.
Has there been a lot of response?
I think we're up to, the last I heard was a few days ago, we were up at about 20. So,
okay.
But that's probably old information at this point. So. Mm-hmm.
Anything else from anyone? Reg.
One more thing is that we are preparing a report for the City Council for the August 24th council study session that will relate to franchise fees. And the commission will get a copy of that report once it's available to the general public on the 21st of August.
Are they suggesting maybe we should attend that, or?
No, that night it would be a written report. Okay. I don't know if there would be any discussion of it, but it's something that was on their work plan to get an update from us on franchise fees and what's happening with them.
Okay. Thank you. Anything else, anyone? I would entertain a motion to adjourn. Oh, I'm sorry.
Chair.
Go right ahead.
Chair, commissioners. Sorry, I was 5 minutes late and I missed my window, I guess, when I usually give a report. But that first 5 minutes must have flown by. I missed it. So it sounds like, Reg, you did get our updates on our Internet Essentials program. Okay. Kate wasn't sure if it would get to you in time for the meeting, but I encourage you to look through it. This is our fifth year of Internet Essentials. And every year we've made a number of enhancements, and I guess the theme of the night is kind of evolving and staying current and relevant, and that's what we do with this program. You know, some of the highlights is that we're now giving free Wi-Fi routers to Internet Essential subscribers, and so, you know, clearly the benefits of that are, you know, a number of different children, parents can use the Internet at the same time in each of these houses. We have we're doubling the speed from 5 megabytes to 10 without increasing the price, so that's still $9.95 a month. We are expanding auto enrollment. We've come up with a program where if a child is in a school where 50%, at least 50% of the student population qualifies for free or reduced national lunch program, all students in the school automatically are eligible for the program. And so, we've made that enhancement, and we've connected 500,000 families. So if you count, most families have 4 in a household. That's over 2 million people and counting. So, and, you know, this was mentioned before about kind of reaching a broader population on technology, but we are starting a senior citizen pilot program for Internet Essentials, and so you'll be hearing more about that, but we're really excited about that. And that goes well. I mean, it complements how we approach this in that we also give a lot of digital literacy training courses. We do a lot around here and have invested quite a bit of money in those because, you know, all the studies show that obviously cost of internet is a huge barrier that causes a digital divide, but also just relevancy. A lot of people say that they don't know why internet is relevant to their lives or how to make it relevant. And so that's a big part of our initiative as well. And, you know, I think it's interesting to read the Internet Essentials customer survey data. Now that this is going on our fifth year, we've been able to collect a lot of data from subscribers in the program. And you'll find some of the highlights interesting, but, you know, 98% of families are using their service for schoolwork. And 92 in this group feels their service had a positive impact on their child's grades. 52% are using the service to search for a job. Things like that. It's a great program, and we're staying committed. On some other exciting things, and this kind of goes to your discussion you had about state of the art and speeds. You know, I am so proud to work for this company that is constantly evolving. Constantly putting research and development into making and keeping our network state of the art, and I think, you know, there's been a lot of talk about fiber tonight, and, you know, we're putting fiber deeper and deeper into neighborhoods all the time, and also what we've been able to do is work on and develop great modems that deliver speed over the internet that we have, and you're going to hear. In the end of this month, we're doing yet another speed increase for all of our customers. And, you know, this is our 12th increase in 10 years. I mean, it is, we don't sit still. And we don't let technology happen around us. You know, we make it happen. And so we're going to have our, and this is happening at the end of the month, and you'll hear a big launch around it. But a lot of our customers that have, so it's going to be a speed increase without an increased cost, and we do that quite a bit. And it will be our performance tier, so 25 megs will go up to 50, blast is our 50 megabyte tier. That's going to go up to 105. And Extreme, customers that have Extreme 105 is going to go are going to go up to bumped up to 150. So that'll be exciting. And as you mentioned, you know, we're rolling out our 2 gig, and by the end of next year, we plan to have our 1 gig product rolled out to every subscriber that can get service from Comcast. And as you know, in your city, we're very belt out here.
Will you have to have a little a different? Well, if you have a Comcast modem, probably it will just. Will you have to reboot the modem to get the additional speed? Do you have to get a different modem?
Sure. So when we do the double your speed, we're going to put out a big announcement in a bill message to let customers know they are going to have to cycle their modem.
Okay.
To pick up the increased speeds.
If you're not getting a modem from Comcast, but you have your own modem, do you have to get a different modem?
I don't think so, but I do think you're going to have to cycle through. Assuming that your modem is capable to pick up the speeds, we do deal with a lot of modems that are outdated. And then we get a lot of calls saying, I'm supposed to be getting 50, and it says I'm getting 30. Well,
so
a lot of times it's a modem issue.
Maybe you may not know the answer to this, but I'll ask the question. The DOCSIS standard, which is, I think, 3.0 right now.
Yep.
That's going to change later in the year. Will this increase speed if you have a modem that does the current standard? Will it be okay for what you're going to be doing?
So for the increased speeds that are coming, the immediate increased speeds that are coming at the end of the month,
mm-hmm.
That does not require a new modem.
Okay.
When we roll out our 1 gig offering,
that'll be different.
That is an upgraded modem. That is your DOCSIS 3.1 that you're referencing, a new modem class. And so there'll be plenty of time to notice you on that. But that's what's coming next. And it is going to be cool. Yeah. So that's what I got tonight. Can I answer any questions?
And could you reiterate what the number of people then it reaches? Did you say 2 million?
For Internet Essentials?
Yes, please.
Yes.
2 million. Yep. And then is that nationwide?
That's nationwide, yeah.
Okay.
And
I wish I could pull the Minnesota number right now.
Yeah, I was going to say, do you know?
And I can't, but I will email it to you. I'll email it to Reg tomorrow morning.
That would be good.
And I'm going to get in a lot of trouble.
That's counting families. So if there's a family of four, each would be.
Yep, so households. I'll give you the
household
number. Yep, mm-hmm. So nationwide, it's 500,000 households.
Should be applauded for that. That's very good, I think.
Any details on the senior program or what that might entail?
Sure.
Or the criteria to qualify?
Yeah. I'm a senior.
They're starting it in, sorry, I'm reading this, in Palm Beach County and a couple more markets in the weeks ahead. They haven't rolled out here yet, so I'm not well versed on what the criteria is. I'll get back to you on that.
That's
one
fine.
Too.
I can search it and find it. No problem.
Besides, he's senior. He won't remember after our meeting tonight.
Oh. Yeah, you'll have to send me an email.
Sorry, I couldn't resist.
Rough crowd tonight.
Scott, edit that out, please.
All right. Thank you so much for your time. Yeah.
Thanks, Carly.
Thank you very much. All right. Anything else in anybody's mind tonight? If not, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Meeting is adjourned.